Thank you, Bill, so much for being with us. I'm just going to ask you a few questions about your entry into activism. And I'll start with, what events or beliefs in your youth led you to be an activist?
You know, I was thinking about this. I mean, there was much that preceded, but there was one event in particular, and that was I was living in a collective household in Stockton, California. This was the spring of 1970. And I was a freshman, and I had been against the war, and had read a lot, but I was sort of a passive anti-war participant. And President Nixon invaded Cambodia at the end of April of 1970, and then just a couple days after that, there were the killings at Kent State in Ohio with four young people shot and killed. And it was this kind of crazy making moment. It was that, no, this cannot continue. And so, there were campuses all across the country that went on strike, including ours at the University of the Pacific. And it was the first time, I went to talk to sororities about the war. And one of the people who lived in the apartment is in this big kind of rambling collective household. She was an English teacher at Manteca High School. And so it was the first time that I went to talk to a high school class about the war. And so it was this moment of great sorrow and anger, but also of exhilaration about being with all these people who were kind of rising up as one to say no, that this just cannot continue. So I think that was a key piece. That was my George Floyd moment, I guess, if you want to put it in contemporary terms. Just the no, this can't hold. That we have to say no. We have to rise up in opposition. And it's that it's that finding other people. When you rise up, you don't rise up alone. You rise up together, and you realize that there are all these wonderful, people of conscience who were there with you. And that's sort of the joy of activism.
So what continues to motivate you, guide you, give you courage?
Well, I think still that community, that being part of that wonderful community of activists. And that's a piece of it. The other piece, of course, is that the enormity of injustice remains. Just to take a personal example, here I am in my home where I've been locked for the last 9 days because of the climate change produced wildfires burning throughout the West. This is just one piece, but an enormous piece, the climate crisis that needs addressing. It's the climate crisis. It's, it's the brutality, the murders of African Americans, the incredible inequality around the world, the way that the COVID crisis is just crashing so unequally throughout the world. So there's this bundle of injustice, but also what has always kept me going has been, this community of, this community of conscience, people who see themselves as part of making the world a better place and who are not in it looking for how they can personally profit, but for how they can, how they can do good work. I was thinking about these questions, and I know that this gets used a lot, this quote, but there's at the end of Howard Zinn's autobiography, he says, "To be hopeful in bad times is not just foolishly romantic. It is based on the fact that human history is a history not only of cruelty, but also of compassion, sacrifice, courage, kindness." And he goes on, "If we remember those times and places, and there are so many where people have behaved magnificently, this gives us the energy to act, and at least the possibility of sending the spinning top of a world in a different direction." It's that sense, and it's that historical sense. I'm a history teacher. And so it's knowing that this is not just a contemporary thing, that I feel connected to people throughout history and the people that I've met in my travels, in my work. You know, I remember being in South Africa in 1986 during the state of emergency and meeting with young people in Mitchell's Plain. It's a so-called colored township outside of Cape Town. There's this big troop carrier at the end of the block in this school that we're in. And I'm meeting with this student representative council, 14-year-olds, totally illegal, this meeting. And one young man, boy, who at one point said, "Such little people, such big decisions." I thought it was just such a wonderful moment, you know, that yes, that so much of the struggle in the world has been, you know, has been young people. And so, you know, just feeling connected to, you know, to the old and the young and this current of resistance. You know, I just finished the book by Barbara Ransby, the biography of Ella Baker. You know, she says, the struggle is eternal. Someone else carries on. You know, there's also this sense that, you know, we don't have to do it all, that these are seeds that we're planting and that we just have the confidence that, you know, that this goes on.
So what advice do you have for young activists?
Yeah, that's a tough one. One thing, as I mentioned just a moment ago, is just to know that young people have been a force in history. That if you think about Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, the student representative councils, the young people in the anti-war movement. You know, when I was arrested in 1971 blocking a draft board, and we were basically all teenagers doing that. And so to just know that you don't have to wait your turn, that your turn is now, that's one thing. I think, you know, another is that the struggle to make the world a better place is not just about winning victories. It's about building awareness. It's about building consciousness and commitment and relationships. And so it's to not be focused on just kind of the things or the artifacts. I think that that's a really important thing, because can get discouraged easily if we don't win what we're looking for. But there's other winning. You know, when we win new people in the movement, that's a win. When people get smarter about what's at the root of the crisis, that's a win. And I think that's another thing too, is to, and this took me a long time when I was in high school, but to think systemically, to be willing and able to name the capitalist system, that so much of the injustice that we see around us is because we have an economic system that is premised on private profit. That is just this kind of fundamental evil that needs to be transformed. And it also intersects with other systems of white supremacy and of patriarchy and extractivism. But I think we need to think systemically and keep those kind of big pictures in mind, even as we do the small work.
Thank you, Bill, very much. I appreciate it.
Yeah, take care.